Good morning. It's still morning because according to Japanese time, we are not yet, we've not yet at lunch and we are adjusting ourselves to Spanish time. I'm coming from Asia, so it's easy for me. So my name is Philippe Delorme. I'm in charge of the energy management business and I'm here with Rodolphe. So Rodolphe, maybe you can introduce yourself.
Hello everyone, good morning. I'm Rodolphe Dargeuzon. I'm a technology analyst with Verdantix, and we specialize in smart building technologies, and it's my pleasure to be here today with Philippe to present with you.
So, we are, the title of the strategic talk is An All Electric World. You've heard from Jean-Pascal, we live in a world where energy and automation are coming together. And though it's going to be hard, we're going to try to concentrate more on the electrical side. There was one figure that's pretty striking in what Jean-Pascal talked about. There were many figures that were very striking, but one was specifically striking about the fact that the electricity consumption is going to double in the coming 20 years. That means that in the coming 20 years, we're going to consume more energy than what we've done in the past 150 years. So that's a staggering change. And our goal today with Rodolphe is really to explain you the why and the how, taking a bit of distance on this energy world that's becoming more electric. So that's part one. And the second piece of our strategic talk is to, as many of you are in business, either as a partner or are running with power and electricity, to share with you how we see the impact of a more electric world in our businesses. And then if we have time, we'll be happy to take questions so that we make that session as interactive as possible. So now, without further ado, let's take a bit of distance and go through and hear from you, Rodolphe, about what do we mean with a more electric world and how is it, where is it coming from and how is it going to work?
Thank you very much, Philippe. Now, Jean-Pascal Tricoire in his keynote started us on this topic, right? And if we're talking about an all-electric world, we're talking about decarbonization, and so we have to start here, we have to start with climate change. And you've all seen some of this, right? Every time you open the newspaper, you see some of this. And so what's really changed? Why are we still talking about it? Why is it relevant, right? It's relevant because it's a starting point. It's also relevant and it's really important to remember what's different now from 10 years ago. 10 years ago, the conversation was, well, how much is it happening? Do we need to worry? What are different solutions? You know, can we get people on board with this? You know, how are we going to change? What's the cost of that change? How much is all this going to cost? And actually, there's a bit of change of era, right? We're now in an era where there's much greater certainty, right? We can measure all these things. We can see what's happening very much clearly. We've got greater certainty on the mechanisms that are going to take us away from that. It doesn't mean it's an easy path, but that is the big change. And if you remember anything from this introduction, right, that actually it's all about certainty and much more clarity now. Because we can work out that we have, what, twice as many huge major incidents as we used to. We can measure the size of the sea rise, right? 3 millimeters per year at the moment. It doesn't seem like much. You put that on a few centuries and it becomes very dramatic. We can work out we've got approximately 20 million climate refugees today. And we know the estimates as you look out to 2050, depending on how the other factors play out, you know, take us to something like, well, up to 1 billion climate refugees. So absolutely dramatic impacts that are very much undisputed, right? And in response, we're seeing everybody take action, right? And the action comes from different angles and different ways. And the scientists is very much, you know, constantly working on this, feeding into the IPCC process. And again, we've got more clarity. And the clarity, as Jean-Pascal was saying earlier, is not always good news, right? The latest numbers coming out of climate modeling are putting the range of climate warming on the 2 to 7 degree path, right? This is much worse than we heard a few years ago. This is much worse than we were considering a few years ago, right? So we have that clarity and it's not always good clarity. It's hard not to talk about the activists at the moment. Now, activism can be a bit hit and miss, But actually, at the moment, some of the issues are really sticking, right? What are the things that are really sticking? Plastics, right? And the broad sustainability movement around that. But also consciousness amongst younger people. And like it or not, the message that Greta Thunberg has become a standard bearer of is resonating, right? And now you go into any school and you've got books on development, climate change, sustainable cities. And we've got politicians, you know, they do what they do, they're at the front of the scene and they negotiate treaties and sometimes it goes right, sometimes it goes wrong. But actually what's much more interesting is as we get to the next part, to say, well, what's happening in the background, right? Climate change is a starting point that takes us on a road of decarbonization. And in Europe, this started in 2008, right, with a climate and energy package, which was voted through in December 2008, which has been implemented since. And actually, it's a success. Again, when I talk about this clarity, we have that clarity, right? The subsidies have worked, right? All those questions about how much will it cost? Is it going to be feasible? You know, the economic incentives, we're there, right? We can produce renewable energy at grid parity. You can buy your solar power at $40 per megawatt hour in California. You can buy your onshore and your offshore wind at 45 and 55 pounds per megawatt hour in the UK, compared to nuclear, which is, you know, at 90-odd. So, you know, that has worked. And that has spurred a huge amount of investment in renewable technology. And obviously, this is the front of the picture, right? So there's good news here, right? Huge growth, 14% globally year on year, we're installing capacity. It's nearly 30% in China, right? Think about it, 30% capacity growing year on year, compared to, at the moment, 4% increase in electrical consumption. Right? So that's good news. There's a lot happening behind the scenes. You've got to make all of that work, and that's the whole smart grid agenda that unfortunately we haven't got time to discuss, but I'm sure there's many interesting discussions possible here today if you want to get stuck in smart grid agenda. And the mobility agenda, right? This is data for the UK. We're approaching 20,000 public charging points. It's about 1% of where we need to be to support an all-electric fleet. But that's growing 40% year on year. And that's taking us much more clearly towards a more electric world, right? Where the economics work, the infrastructure is developing, and the uses are developing as well.
So we see clearly that the figures are staggering when it comes to a more electric world. Now, Jean-Pascal said it in his strategy talk, energy and digital are very, very related. What we see is that actually we will not get any efficiency on the OT world if we don't leverage the IT side of the house. Not mentioning the fact that all of us are getting more addicted with phones and that all machines are driving more and more traffic. So the bottom line is that the world is becoming more electric for sure, but then in parallel, there is a need to correlate that new electric world with a new digital world to bring together those two worlds together for the benefit of our customers. So when we look at what's happening practically, the old electric world comes with more renewable, more electric loads because electrical loads are more efficient, more availability, more storage, more DC and DC. So the bottom line is electricity is developing very fast because it's the most efficient energy. That means that this tsunami of change is absolutely not here to go to stay. It's going to be developing extremely, extremely fast. Now, on the other side, the world is becoming more digital with more data, more software, more analytics, and the whole equation that we see with our customers is on one side to make sure that we bring this powertrain in a very reliable manner, in a very efficient manner, but that we also connect the whole energy equation with the process of our customers. And that's where the electrical world and the digital world are coming together, and that's precisely the space in which Schneider Electric has decided to operate. So that's about the big picture and how and why we see the world becoming more electric, painting a first level of opportunity in the new electric world. Now, let's hear from about end users, about customers, about what they see, and what you hear, Rodolphe, let's say, as you are engaging with many of those companies?
Yes, thank you. You know, at Verdantix, one of our missions is to talk to the whole market, right? As an industry analyst, we speak to everyone. And we spend a lot of time collecting data and interviewing people, your peers, on what influences their strategy, which direction they're going in. And we speak to about 500 executives a year and poll them on some of the key questions, right? To understand to what extent these key questions that Philippe was developing, right, around digitization and around all electric, is penetrating people's mind. And this is an extract from this year's survey, right, when we're asking people, you know, what is going to be influencing your strategy? And when we ask about, you know, on-site power and electric vehicles, right, we're talking about the new energy paradigm, actually a majority, 76%, say, yeah, that is going to be pretty influential on our strategy. Now, this tells me, yes, it is penetrating people's subconscious, and that's why, in a way, there are so many people here at this event, right? Everybody recognizes this is an important path and a disruptive path. I'll tell you what it doesn't mean, though. It doesn't mean that 76% of companies have got it right, right? It's a tricky path, right? And there's a lot of unrealized potential along the way. And there's nothing more difficult than putting in an electric charging point if you haven't planned for it in advance. It looks simple, it's a small box, but then you need to rethink all your assumptions on your electrical infrastructure to cope with the extra demand that's going to coming through, right? So it looks simple, but this is actually a very big story. And it's important and it's very positive that people are responding so positively to that factor of change. And on the other side of that, there's digital. And obviously, as a technology analyst, this is extraordinarily important. We spend a lot of time saying, well, what is it in your world that you're considering? And what are the solutions that you think, you know, we need to be out there trying, testing, and all that? And what you see on screen is a mix of the old and the new, right? From a building management system all the way up to IoT platforms for buildings. And we don't have digital twins on the slide because that's too confusing at this stage, but that's going to be the next generation. Right? And what do we see? We see a huge appetite, right, for people to try out and try out digital solutions, right? One of the most common comments I hear from people is, I've got all this data, what am I going to do with it? How am I going to make sense of it? How do I make it visible, right, to me, to the operator, to the executive? How can you give me that single pane of glass, right? On a building, on a portfolio level. And so, very interesting to see IoT platforms for building at the top end of the pile, right? A lot of people thinking, how are we going to get value from this? How's all that data going to feed through? So terrific, I'd say we're right on topic, right?
So, now, let's talk about concrete examples, because we clearly see that the world becoming more electric. We see that digital trend going in parallel. We have many questions for our customers saying, okay, so that's all very interesting, but what does it mean for me? And how can I deploy this in the context of my installation? So let's start with one customer case, and then I'll comment further to explain what has been the work behind the scene to make it happen for this customer that you will discover right away.
Suomalainen luonto on mulle tosi tärkeä. Se on läsnä vapaa-ajassa ja harrastuksissa, ja on hienoa, että mä voin tehdä jotain sen hyväksi myös työn puitteissa. Mun nimi on Kalle Hintikka ja mä vastaan Lil Suomi Koyssä jakelukeskusrakentamisesta. Päivittäistavarakauppa on osa kaikkien arkea, ja sen takia meillä on iso vastuu siitä, miten me kehitetään meidän toimintaa. Kun me lähdettiin suunnittelemaan Järvenpää jakelukeskusta, me ei vielä tiedetty, onko meidän tarpeisiin vastaavia ratkaisuja olemassakaan. Schneider Electricin kanssa me onnistuttiin löytämään sellaista. Me haluttiin kiinteistö, joka toimii kokonaan uusiutuvalla energialla ja joka oppii optimoimaan omaa energiankäyttöä niin, että myös päästöt on mahdollisimman pienet. Se onnistui yhdistämällä Schneiderin EcoStruxure, kiinteistöhallintajärjestelmä ja Microgrid Advisor. Se hakee tietoa ulkopuolelta, energiahinnoista ja säätilasta ja opettaa tätä rakennusta ennakoimaan tilanteita ja optimoimaan kulutusta. Tämän mikroverkkokokonaisuuden avulla me voidaan tasata meidän energiatarpeita. EcoStruxroa ja kaikkea tämän talon toimintaa. Sen avulla me ollaan ensimmäisenä Suomessa yhdistetty lämmitys- ja jäähdytysjärjestelmät niin, että jäähdytyksessä syntyvä lämpö voidaan varastoida ja hyödyntää, kun sää kylmenee. Laskelmien mukaan me ollaan pääsemässä yli 70% säästöä energiakustannuksissa. Tämä kiinteistö on hiilineutraali, ja me vähentää myös lähes voimalaitoksen hiilidioksidipäästöjä varsinkin kesäaikaan. Yhteistyö Schneider Electricin kanssa on avointa ja eteenpäin vievää. Schneiderin toiminnassa näkyy myös kansainvälisyys, niin kuin meilläkin. Tämä on hyvä alku yhteistyölle ja toivotan, että päästään tekemään lisää jatkossakin.
So pretty staggering figures in terms of sustainability, in terms of efficiency. A very iconic customer that we with whom we've been working for quite some time. Actually, behind this, a lot of work. A lot of work to build and invent a new electric world. So you've seen that very large factory with a customer willing to go fully efficient and fully sustainable. So that goes with actually a lot of technology. Of course, renewable. With renewable comes solar, comes energy storage and a connection to the grid. Some edge computing, some combination of alternative current, direct current. So all of it looks very easy, not so easy to deploy actually, and requiring a lot of technology and a lot of know-how to make sure that it would work when Lidl needs that energy to be indeed becoming green and sustainable, but also coming efficient. On the other side, you've seen a lot of automation to plug the powertrain to the process of the customer. So in the case of that customer, of course, the building automation, making sure that everything would run per the plan, that the central spine of the building would work optimally and real time, a microgrid that connects with the electrical side, real time optimization of the whole building system with building advisor, and so on and so on. So you see exactly what we were illustrating before, which is on one side a customer very obsessed by sustainability, but very geared after efficiency, that has taken a full choice of running with an electrical powertrain. And on the other side, to make sure that this customer would run very efficiently, that customer made the choice to have a central spine, a building automation that would be real-time combined with the whole powertrain that came green and sustainable. So, a perfect example of a new electric world, a new electric world that's also more digital. And I would say, as a member of the executive committee of Schneider Electric, I can tell you examples like this are popping up everywhere in the world. And with, let's say, an acceleration of the request, because all of our customers, Jean-Pascal was saying it, are more and more driven by, on one side, sustainability for sure, but also that reach for efficiency, because in the end, they have to deliver the bottom line.
And I think that's a very important point, right? 10 years ago, when we were talking about microgrids, we were talking about, you know, resilience. Let's disconnect from the grid, let's be secure, right? It was all about army bases and stuff like that. Now we're talking about a microgrid in terms of huge efficiency. There's sustainability benefits, but as you were saying, Lidl is very motivated by efficiency, right?
Yep.
And that's a real shift in 10 years.
Yep. So we see that acceleration, and actually that acceleration from time to time can be a bit overwhelming. And this is where the network of partners that Schneider Electric has been developing is really, really important. There are many partners actually in this crowd, and we thank you for your business. These are a few figures, and they are pretty impressive in terms of the number of partners that Schneider Electric can deploy on specific application. And actually, making these partners work together, because in the case of Lidl, and we'll see another case right after, we see that there are many specialties in the field of power and secure power, in the field of automation, that needs, let's say, a full solution to be put in place at the design and the build, and of course at the operation and maintenance, where we want to make sure that we accompany the different end users with the technology of Schneider Electric. So this big crowd of partners has to come together, and I would say more and more as we go through the full life cycle of design, build, operate and maintain. And actually it's interesting to see that the more we go into those more advanced applications, the more we see a need to rally together different crowds of partners that were not exactly used to work kind of real time together. Of course, every project starts with a design firm, a specifier that we engage a lot to make sure that we, I wouldn't say we preach the principle of EcoStruxure, but make sure that we clarify what would be future thinking architecture in the field of energy and in the field of automation. And then there is a whole chains of execution, the panel builders, the contractor, the system integrator when it comes to automation, where we see a big need actually to coordinate and to orchestrate that network of partners, those 600,000 partners, to make sure that the whole technology of Schneider Electric will come in a coordinated manner along the life cycle. Jean-Pascal was talking about that integration of design, build, commission, operate and maintain. Very important to accompany, let's say, the digital twin creation down to a real live infrastructure with this network of partners. We are launching today Exchange, which is, call it a marketplace for all our partners to work together. And we believe it's a key ingredient of driving that digital and new electric world to bring very practical solution for our customers. So we wanted to take a second example. You wanted to say something?
I just want to add something to that because it's easy to forget how big this industry is, right? I was looking at numbers for Spain, right? Between building services and construction, we're talking 14% of GDP, yep. Right? It's an enormous, enormous industry. And hence, that's why there are so many silos, so many experts, right? Because you have to chop the job up in a way that we can do it. And this type of solution, from my perspective as an external analyst, is extraordinarily important because everybody recognizes the huge efficiency gain, but how to make it happen is, it's a huge topic. So exchanging the right information, and I think, you know, that leads to some other hot topics, right? When we talk about BIM and digital twins, the ability to model through the life cycle.
For sure.
I think is a topic that for the next, 5-10 years is going to be an important part of the digitization of this whole process.
Sure. So we committed at the beginning of this session to be as concrete and practical as possible. So to illustrate the new electric world and to illustrate, let's say, the power of this partner at scale in orchestration, this time we are not going to practice Finnish because it might be a bit exclusive for that crowd. We're going to practice Spanish and talk about a customer reference that actually we created with a partner in Spain. So let's have a look.
Se ha convertido en un punto y una referencia turística muy interesante. Los hoteles hoy por hoy tienen que instalar, invertir y apostar por la eficiencia energética. Kaixo, mi nombre es Mikel Zaldúa Olabeaga y soy el director del hotel La Sala Plaza. Está ubicado en la confluencia de la parte vieja y del puerto, con las mejores vistas y diferentes que hasta la fecha el turista está acostumbrado de ver de San Sebastián. Nos decantamos por la instalación inteligente porque de alguna forma simplifica la gestión, porque facilita el uso. Y en este sentido, Schneider Electric tiene todo lo que realmente un hotel de nueva inversión necesita. Las soluciones de Schneider Electric es un antes y un después en el modelo de gestión y mantenimiento de los hoteles. Nos ayuda para que en aquel dispositivo que estemos en ese momento podamos tener una visión general de cómo está el hotel, si están las habitaciones ocupadas, si están las luces encendidas, si el control de temperatura es el adecuado. Y esto al final redunda en el confort y sobre todo en la eficiencia y en la eficacia de la gestión del hotel. Tanto Irulezo como Schneider Electric captaron la idea en un primer momento y se pusieron a trabajar para dar la mejor solución. Mi relación con Irulezo es de absoluta transparencia y comodidad y confianza. El Hotel La Sala Plaza espera de Irulezo y de Schneider Electric que tengamos un compañero de viaje que nos vaya aportando todas las innovaciones que existen en el mercado para que aún seamos más eficientes.
customer testimony. So first of all, indeed, this is Schneider Electric technology, but the last mile of delivering this technology is coming with a partner. Sorry about that. And that's okay. He's coming with a partner, and that's important in the whole construct for the end user. The second one is, Jean-Pascal was talking a lot about a very critical application where power is really important. You might think that a hotel is a, let's call it, a non-critical application. Now, for anyone who's been woken up at 2 a.m. in the morning with a fire alarm coming from an electrical panel, it happened to me a few times in the past 2 years. It's not really nice. And that's one of the nightmares of these people. So even for non-critical application, it's a powerful reminder that actually power is always critical. When we say life is on everywhere, at every time, at every moment, and our technology here at Schneider are allowing for life is on, what's behind is the fact that there is no life, and there is no life in a building or in a customer process if power is off. And it's really important that all topic of uptime and reliability is very critical for very high-end application like data center in oil and gas, but equally critical in a case like this. The third point that's interesting in that application is that all parallel between the power and that gentleman was talking about how critical having a clear view on his powertrain is, but also how important it is to make sure that that whole power application would be connected with the process of that customer, whether guest room management or the whole information system. So in the end, we started the day with a keynote of Jean-Pascal talking about energy and automation together as, let's say, the two key ingredients, the two key applications that we believe will allow deliver sustainability but then efficiency for these customers. And we've tried to illustrate this through these two customer examples out of, let's say, a broader picture, which is a world becoming more electric for a very simple reason, which is the electricity is the most efficient energy, whether on the generation side or on the consumption side. So that's what we wanted to share with you today. We are open for questions. We still have 5 minutes for questions, should you have any. And then we'll call it a day afterwards, opening up for lunch, which will be a very important part of your day too. Any question in the room?
Because we can't hear the questions if we don't have that.
That's good.
Philippe, can you hear me?
Yep.
I have one question. During the various visits, I've heard about edge computing was becoming a big trend. How will it impact the building in the future?
So maybe let's redefine edge computing. So when I was saying that actually we are more and more dependent on electricity, we see with IT developing, let's say some IT application that needs to be operating very, very fast, and where servers actually are very close to the user. So that's pushing. So we all talk a couple years ago about cloud and everything going to data centers, big data center. With, let's say, very fast application, we see a few applications going to servers that are more decentralized. That's what we call edge computing. So you've seen, I hope you've seen some local cabinets here talking about some offers where actually you would put together in buildings, say retail shops and these kind of things, cabinet where you would have secure power close to the server room, close to the cooling, all integrated to make it super simple, super reliable to deploy. So what we see out of that IT trend of edge computing, meaning some compute power moving decentralized to the loads, is a big need for cabinets that will include the server but the secure power, very centralized, as many power points, as secure power points across the building that will have to be closely managed and tightly integrated in the whole powertrain. So we see it as a pretty big trend where we are responding with both hardware and software offers. And I would say on that part of the house, the growth is staggering. And More to come if you want to know more about that. There are a few demos over there in the space dedicated to data centers. Thanks for the question. Maybe one more question?
Actually, if I can add a few comments on the edge computing comment. If you change the terminology, it becomes very easy to see what's going on, right? If you think about local versus what needs to happen locally versus what can happen elsewhere. And you think about your building operations, and there's a certain amount of stuff that will always need to happen locally, right? Where on some aspects of your building control, some aspects of your security, for instance, has to be local. And then you've got access to the cloud, which gives you scalability, amazing computing power, flexible deployment models for your software, et cetera. And so you're always balancing the two. The cloud is cheap and storage is cheap, but if you send all of your data from your building up to the cloud, eventually you will get a sizable bill, right, in terms of all that data. So you're going to use some of the data locally, you're going to work out what you need to send up to the cloud, how you get more value and how you get balance between what happens locally and what happens in the cloud. And I think when you think about it in those terms, the equation becomes very obvious.
Thank you. Yep, there's a question over there.
Hello? Yeah, yep. Can you hear me? Yeah. Electrification and obviously decarbonization is pretty much across all the sectors. My question is, how do you see the challenges of integrating the systems from the bottom level up to the, from the hardware, where you might see different SCADA systems, different hardware, some of the hardware or equipment might not be manufactured, the manuals are not there, and how do you get data and integrate it into your operation, overall integration platforms. But also from the software point of view, there's a lot of suppliers and they have different protocols, and again, how do you integrate them to get the most value out of the data from different legacy systems as well. So there are a lot of challenges I can see. What are your solutions here? And what Schneider as a supplier, what do you think in terms of you can contribute to the protocol or standards from the bottom up to all the data analytics? That's my question. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a very good question. Thanks for asking it, and probably one of the most difficult ones. So maybe a few points to answer to that one. Number one, as Schneider, we totally believe into open protocols and open architecture. Jean-Pascal was talking about Transparent Factory 1979, which was, let's say, our first attempt to put IP on the shop floor of manufacturing, of industrial automation. And I would say since then, we've been apostles, if not more, of driving open protocol, let's say, on the edge, on the software stacks. And if you look at the basic operating principle of EcoStruxure, it's all built on open standards, actually leveraging a lot of third-party technology. We were right before with Microsoft, where we work quite a bit with Azure, but not only. And we believe it's really important. So that's one. Second point is, and that's maybe more recent, but we are working to make sure that especially our advisors and our cloud services are as agnostic as possible to whatever install base. That means that our cloud offers are designed and more designed. I'm not saying it's perfect, but we are working toward that goal to make sure that we would connect to any system, let's say, that is connectable. In that one, we know that not everybody is equal, and some systems are closer than others. But with the systems that are reasonably open, we try to build our technology to make it really open for those systems would be ready to talk to us. Then the last one is to build offers, so we call it software-defined power, where in the case of power infrastructure, where we add small, let's say IoT devices that are as cost effective as possible that we can plug to the architecture. So we talk, for instance, about PowerTag, which is that small device that we would put on a Schneider breaker or an ABB breaker or a Siemens breaker, and that would become a wireless, batteryless meter that would send the energy data very, very simply. So that's one example. We talk about the thermal detection. We are actually working on simple products that we can instrument on our breaker or the breakers of competition to give the on-off indication. So we are working more and more on those, let's say, add-on, very simple add-on that could go into open IP architecture to make sure that not only we have open architecture on the side of Schneider, but we can easily and openly connect to third party and to competition. And we are absolutely clear that we believe openness will win and will prevail in the digital world. That's very obvious. Now, complicated to execute, but we, I would say in that front, we feel pretty good on the progress we are making. Maybe one last question? Ah. Another one? Ah, another one.
Since the audience is quiet, so I ask it in my second question, right? So obviously, the Schneiders, obviously, you have, I've seen a lot of products from you know sensors up to these ecosystems. Now, I'm asking for a lot of SMEs, really, a lot of SMEs where you talk about the, you know, 250 or less, means that they are solutions. You want to provide the solutions for them. They probably cannot afford it. And also, they are technically, they're not be able to maintain a system as well. So, firstly, is the cost. The second is the maintenance as well. Obviously, you could provide those services through third party. But I think, you know, in terms of the SMEs, where a lot of countries, European countries, particularly also the developed countries, a lot of them are 90% are SMEs. So how your Schneider would be provided solutions, there'll be low cost as well. And so that means we'll help with the digitalization and the transformation as well. That's my question. Thank you.
Great question. Can we give you a job or? We need more. We need better marketing at Schneider. So that's it's a great question. It's another great question, and I would say it's a. When we engage into digital discussion with customers, I would say today we are at a point where everybody realizes they have to go into digital transformation. So step one is done. Step two is how and how much. So on how, I would say we are bringing better solution and better practical solution and faster. On the how much, there is really a perception to kill, which is digital is expensive. The thing is, as digital is spreading and as cloud applications are spreading very fast, what's very striking is that it's possible today to come with simple digital solution as entry point that will allow our customers to start that journey of digital. Let me take you an example. We ship every year at Schneider 500 million circuit breakers. And when we look at that, we say, today we have 2 million assets under management, so that means that there is a huge amount of breakers that are not being connected. So we work very hard to make sure that at the time of commissioning, we would have an easy option for digital that actually could come with some gateways or not. A first level of digitization would be just QR code and a logbook to allow to monitor and to map and to keep track of your whole installation, that comes with marginal cost. Now, I'm not saying that all EcoStruxure is coming at zero price, because it's a menu from very simple application, take a logbook with QR code, to a first level of alarming that would be a few hundred euros per month or per year for very simple alarming, which is probably the step one of what anyone wants to see in electrical, up to a menu of most advanced application. And that's really the way we see our future, which is a progressive discovery of very simple application to very complex application on one side. And I would say from a product standpoint, a very easy option of simple and cost-effective connectivity that would not be let's say, super high performance, high speed, and so on, up to higher speed at a higher cost, but being obsessed by simplicity to start with. And there are a few examples on the marketplace where we talk about Facility Expert, PowerTag, and so on, which are coming with tens, hundreds of euros as a first step of digital. So digital is not by nature expensive and cost effective, and the return investment is very often very, very fast. Rodolphe, you wanted to add anything?
I was going to say it's important to look at the specifics of the question, right? We talk about SMEs, they often don't have the same footprint as some of the larger companies, and therefore there's a different set of solutions that come into play, right? And Philippe was highlighting the different solutions that do exist. So I think that's one important factor. I would echo the point around the cost can be a lot less than you think, right? We run quite a lot of conferences on the theme of getting value from technology. And when you do a poll, pretty much the biggest misconception is the cost of getting into more advanced analytics, the cost of SaaS-based solutions. The entry point is really not that high. The final point I would make is we work a lot around smart buildings. Now, smart buildings to us doesn't mean, you know, just a few shiny top-end buildings, right? For me, I see the scope of smart building as every building can be smarter, right? And every building can be smarter in different ways, right? With a different portfolio of solutions, sometimes different economics on that specific project, and you've got to bear that in mind. But actually, we're at the state where the technology across the market tells you, yes, that is possible on much smaller scales than it used to be.
Very good. So time's up. Thanks to all of you. I think it's probably time for a real lunch this time. So thanks for coming here, and we wish you a great coming 2 days with us at the Innovation Summit. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, everyone.